But up next, with Towards Family-Centered ALS Care, development of a guide for ALS care professionals on how to support parents and children and families living with ALS. As always, post your questions for Marion in the Q&A tab on your video screen. Marion?
Hello. My name is Marion Sommer-Spijkerman, and I work as a postdoctoral researcher at the University Medical Center of Utrecht in the Netherlands. In the past 2 years, I worked on the project ALS Parents and Kids Support, with the aim to improve the quality of care for families in which a parent is diagnosed with ALS. One of the aims of this project was to provide ALS care professionals with guidance on how to support parents and children in families living with ALS. This resulted in a practical guide for ALS care professionals on how to provide family-centered ALS care. And in the next 10 to 15 minutes, I will walk you through the guide. But first, let me explain why family-centered ALS care is important and what steps we took to get to this guide. ALS affects not only patients, but also the families surrounding them, especially when children are involved. When a parent is diagnosed with ALS, the family's primary concern is often how the children are coping. Parents worry about the impact of ALS on their children and struggle how to support their children. The well-being of the child affects the well-being of the parents and the other way around. For the quality of life of both parents and children, it is thus crucial that professionals working with families living with ALS not only pay attention to care needs, but also to parental and children's support needs. In the Netherlands, about 40 multidisciplinary ALS care teams are responsible for the care of patients with ALS. These ALS care teams could play an important role in supporting children and empowering parents to support their children. However, due to lacking guidelines, professionals in ALS care teams are often uncertain about how they can provide optimal care to parents and children. With our project, we aimed to provide professionals in these ALS care teams with guidance on how to support parents and children and families living with ALS. In close collaboration with ALS care professionals, patients and relatives in the Netherlands, we developed a practical guide for family-centered ALS care. This guide was developed in 4 steps. In the first step, we conducted a systematic review of the literature on support needs of families with ALS and other life-limiting illnesses. In the second step, we interviewed 21 parents, of whom 8 with ALS, and 15 children living with ALS about their experiences, struggles, and support needs. From the interviews, it becomes clear that parents living with ALS need support in meeting the needs of their children, and that ALS care teams may provide this kind of support to parents. In the third step, we conducted a survey among rehabilitation physicians, social workers, psychologists, nursing specialists, and specialized ALS nurses working in ALS care teams in the Netherlands to determine to what extent there is a match between ALS families' needs and current ALS care practices. The survey was completed by 65 professionals, nearly half were social workers, and they were asked about the types of support they offer to parents and children, as well as their perceived barriers and needs for providing optimal support to families with ALS. From the survey, we identified 2 types of needs. 75% of ALS care professionals expressed the need for information materials aimed at parents and children to be able to educate families about ALS. Further, ALS care professionals indicated that they may benefit from guidance on how to support families. For instance, training and conversation techniques or education about processes of grief and loss among different age groups. In the fourth and last step, we recruited a working group of ALS care professionals and parents living with ALS, with whom we formulated recommendations on how to support families. The findings from the literature study, as well as the input from the survey and interviews, were used to inform the workgroup meetings. To meet professionals' need for information, we developed a number of written information materials for families, including a guide for parents on how to talk to and support children in families with ALS, and an information booklet for children aged between 7 and 12 years old, written in comic form. These materials focus on four topics: how to talk about ALS with children, young caregivers, ALS at school, and grief and loss. As existing information is primarily written, we also developed 9 brief educational videos about family life with ALS, 4 videos for parents and 5 videos for children. And the video content is based on the themes that emerge from the interviews. Besides those information materials, we developed a practical guide to facilitate professionals in supporting parents and children in families with ALS. This guide is clustered around 6 themes. In red are the more generic recommendations, and in blue are more specific recommendations. I will talk you through the main recommendations per theme. The first theme is the working alliance between family and professional. Every family is unique, so support should be tailored to each family's needs, considering, for instance, illness stage and progression, children's developmental stage, familial beliefs and values, and the support network surrounding the family. Professionals should agree with their team who is responsible for what type of support and explain to the families that they're working with what the support will look like. Also important is that professionals and families together decide upon a first point of contact where family members can go when they have questions or concerns. And through sharing knowledge and experiences with colleagues, professionals can learn from each other. We encourage them to ask for help from a colleague inside or outside the network when not feeling prepared to engage in a dialogue about parenting issues or family functioning. The second theme is professional education. Tailoring support to the changing needs of families facing ALS requires awareness, skills, and experience on the part of healthcare professionals serving those families. This emphasizes the necessity of training ALS care professionals in how to support families with ALS. For those professionals who frequently have to deal with families, it may be helpful to receive education and training in conversation techniques with families, the use of tools for screening family dysfunction, and furthermore, ALS care professionals may be expected to have some basic knowledge of processes of grief and loss among different age groups. However, even more important is to have referral options in your network for when families require more guidance than you can offer them. The third theme is awareness of the family system. Professionals should take enough time to get to know a family and to build a trusting relationship. This is crucial to be able to deliver adequate support that is also accepted by the family. Throughout the illness process, it may be helpful to plan conversations with the whole family to identify the needs and concerns of each family member. Moreover, professionals may want to discuss involving family social network and supporting them, for example, relatives, friends, neighbors, or teachers from the children's school. Determine who is important and how they do or could support the family. ALS has an unpredictable course, so professionals must always be alert to changes in family support needs. Identifying support needs is an ongoing process. The fourth theme is attention to parental roles. Within families, changes occur in the division of parental tasks and responsibilities. It's important that professionals discuss these changes and its impact on family life. And they may want to encourage parents to talk about what they need as a parent and discuss where they can meet other parents in the same situation to share experiences. If parents experience difficulties with raising their children and need more support, it's important to inform them about available family support services. Then we go to the 15th, psychoeducation of parents. It's important that professionals discuss the impact of ALS on their children and family life. You can think of transformations in family roles and relationships, and these transformations can be either positive or negative. ALS care professionals may want to educate parents about ALS, teach them how to talk about ALS with their children, how to recognize maladaptation in their child, how to deal with their own and children's emotions, how to involve children in the illness trajectory without burdening them, and make parents aware of opportunities for parenting support. Schools where children spend a great deal of their time may play also an important role in offering emotional support and encouragement to children, for instance through school counseling. To do so, it is crucial that school teachers, mentors, counselors or nurses are adequately educated about how to support students with a parent with a progressive and terminal illness such as ALS. Besides advising parents to inform the school of the children about their home situation, professionals may provide parents with information materials that can be used to educate teachers and other school staff about ALS. The final and sixth theme in the guide is involvement of children in ALS care. ALS care professionals may want to pay structural attention to children's well-being during consultations, not only to meet emotional support needs, but also to be able to identify problems among children in an early stage. Professionals could advise parents on how and when to break the news of the diagnosis to their children, how to educate their children about ALS, how to involve children in care, and educating them about where to seek help for their children. Where the possibilities for ALS care professionals to support children in families with ALS are limited due to time constraints and children being in school during the week, they may offer some sort of educational support to providing children either directly or via their parents with age-specific information about ALS. And finally, it's important to discuss opportunities for child peer support and where children can seek support after parental death. To summarize, ALS care professionals may play an important role in the empowerment of parents and children living with ALS, yet need guidance on how to support families. The newly developed guide for family-centered ALS care facilitates ALS care professionals to provide better information and care to parents and children in families with ALS. Despite being developed in the Netherlands, many of the recommendations in the guide may be applicable in other countries and cultures as well. That brings me to the end of my presentation. Of course, I didn't do all this work by myself. I wish to thank all the researchers, professionals and patients that contributed to our project. Thank you for your attention. Currently, the guide is only available in Dutch. We are very interested to see whether there is international interest in the guide, so please let me know when you're interested. And also, I'm happy to answer any other questions you may have.
Thank you so much. That was excellent. And one of my questions was the English question. So would it be available in English? But you answered that already, so we don't have to go into that. But this looking at the families and the children, we had a panel on it last year at the APF. It's really coming to the forefront of everyone's attention. You know, we all knew about it, but I kind of like we talked about in some of the other presentations, we as clinicians know about it, but having the tools then to how do we deal with it? What do we do? How do we talk to the families? This looks excellent. You know,
it was actually the same here, same situation. Many ALS care professionals know that they should do something with the children, but sometimes they don't know where to start or what they can do. And with this guide, we wanted to offer some simple guidance, so simple practical tips and recommendations, what they can do to actually support children or help parents to support their children.
Yeah, so well, you definitely like this in other languages.
Okay, good to know.
And the Alliance can probably help you make those connections, okay. The International Alliance. This is the place to come for that.
Okay.
So, some other things that I thought were quite interesting is that you had that you were alert to changes. So, you know, so often when we talk about something, somebody, you say, oh, I checked in with them and they were fine, but they might not be fine 3 months from now, 6 months from now.
Exactly. Yes. It's so, the course is also very unpredictable. So it can change every moment. Mm-hmm. What kind of support is needed for a family.
And someone is asking, do you see people bringing children into clinic with them? Or I assume if they're not, then it's something you have to ask about.
Yes. Well, I'm a researcher, so I don't actually know this, but I know from professionals at my my university medical center where I'm working that sometimes parents bring their children, but it's not that often, but also because appointments are often during school times, so it's also often not possible to bring children. But there are rehabilitation physicians that offer the possibility to have a conversation with the whole family, including the children.
Right. So. And I know there was a recommendation last year that we at least put it on our intake form, just like, so it's something that you're asking about is, are there children, you know, the ages and all that.
Yeah.
Another really important piece that you mentioned was you might not always have the answers. You know, as a therapist now, I'm talking to them about these things. They may ask me questions, and it's not that I need to know the answer, but I can tell them where to go.
Yes, that's actually the most important thing, that you have connections and that you know where to refer them.
Yeah.
Because, of course, you don't have the answers to all their questions.
Mm-hmm. So, right. And let's see, Melinda Cavanaugh did post some an English guide for people in the post. I don't see any other
In my presentation, you saw a few information materials that we developed.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So a guide for parents and a comic for children. And those materials are made in collaboration with Melinda Cavanaugh, and we use materials that she developed as a starting point for developing our materials, and then we made changes based on cultural differences, so we adapted it to the Dutch situation. So, but we used her materials as a basis.
Excellent.
So,
That's another example of, you know, somebody has something, you don't just directly translate it, you adapt it to your situation and your culture and your needs.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. I'm very glad, as you know, a member of the Alliance, to hear that those connections are being made. I think we have to wrap up now, but you can get your questions ready for Melinda for the next session.
Okay. But
thank you so much, and if there's any other questions that come in, feel free to answer them in the chat, or anyone can reach out to Marianne to ask any questions.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.